A warm welcome and a very good afternoon to all our viewers. I, on behalf of Rainbow Children's Hospital, Birthright by Rainbow Hospitals, Shrivalli, would be your host and moderator for today's session. The session that we would be discussing today would be related to pertaining to COVID in pregnancy. The topic is pregnancy care in COVID during the era, in this COVID era 2019. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome Dr. Kavita Kovi, our consultant obstetrician and gynecologist, Birthright by Rainbow at Marthinley Hospital, and Dr. Karamjeet Kaur, consultant obstetrician and gynecologist and laparoscopic surgeon, Birthright by Rainbow Marthinley. Welcome, doctor. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you.
So, doctor, we will start off. Viewers are waiting for us, and we have quite a lot of attendees. In between, we will also have questions that are popping up from all your patients who would like to know and ask and seek information about. So, there's so much of doubt about coronavirus, and pregnancy actually is a very, very joyous moment, though there's a lot of pain behind those 9 months, but end of the day, it's more of wellness, and there's a bundle of joy that we are carrying back home, which is why I feel that it's not pain, but it's more of pleasure. And during this time, especially during this time, most of pregnant mothers are very, very skeptical and are very doubtful about a lot of aspects and thought processes, and there's so much more that is running in their minds. I think today, both the panelists, Dr. Kaur and Dr. Kovi, would be able to enlighten us and give us a little bit more brief of what do we need to do and how do we have to do. During this course, before we could start the session and webinar, the whole week we had an exercise that we did with our patients, and patients came up with quite a lot of questions. And, to start off with, what is COVID-19 and related worries and doubts? That's one. And the other thing is, what should pregnant women do during this pandemic era? I think if Dr. Kavita can enlighten us on this and start letting us know what it is so that the viewers can understand. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the webinar. So I know these are unprecedented times. All of us, we just don't know. Probably our parents have seen the pandemics before, and probably they would have heard of. But in this technological era, now having a pandemic like this, I know we have a lot of rumors and a lot of hearsay. There's something which is, which is worrying us, bothering us. And there are lots of things out there in the digital world which you don't know whether to believe or whether not to believe. What is exactly happening to you? I understand it is very, very difficult times. So this SARS-CoV-19, or the new virus which they found in Wuhan, so this is absolute puzzle for everybody. It's not only for the doctors, for the patients, for the research world. Everybody is finding it very difficult. But fortunately, now we have a lot of studies coming in. We have a lot of support from the research staff who have given us a new idea about a lot of insights about this virus. So coming to this virus, it's a coronavirus, as you know. What are the related worries and doubts about it? As I've told you, this is a very new virus. So the lots of research is going on about this virus. And the symptoms and signs was as normal as a common flu, or you have a cough, which is a very dry cough, which is normal in pregnancy. Sometimes you get due to acidity. So there are many confusions in pregnant women, and women have doubts whether pregnant women have a doubt whether I'm going to be affected more than the normal person. Is it going to be difficult for me? Is my immunity low? Because my immunity is low, how do I know whether my immunity is right or not? So many worries in a pregnant woman. All these 2.5 months of our experience in Rainbow has been very good, even with COVID-19 patients. We've been very supportive. The patients also have been very supportive and understanding. And to be very honest, we've done a very good work with them. And we haven't found very bad worries for the patients, or very difficult times for the patients who've been with us, fortunately. And yes, of course, there are patients who've gone through a lot because of the COVID-19, and we really don't know which patient goes through what at a given point of time. But fortunately, pregnant women do not have to worry too much, because it's not as it is left away, to everybody, told to everybody that, you know, pregnant women are more susceptible to COVID-19. It is not like that. You are also, you know, have the same immunological response. You'll have the same kind of problems as a normal person. So any normal person going through a COVID-19 or a pregnant woman are going to be the same. So I think let's start this session with a lot of assurance rather than, you know, be worrying about pregnancy and COVID-19, right? And what should you do in this pandemic era? Any pandemic, everywhere, the golden rules are the same, right? So isolation, keeping away from people who have the disease or contacts, not moving in public places where it's really not necessary, wearing your mask, sanitizing yourself, keeping your hands clean, washing them frequently. This is what we are looking at in every pandemic. These are the golden rules, and that's going to stay even for this pandemic. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Word assurance itself means so much so that, you know, we are all rest assured that any pandemic comes or anything that comes, our doctors at Birthright by Rainbow Hospitals are working 24/7 in emergency care. And also we have a clinic 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. to support all our patients at any given point in time. Thank you so much, ma'am. Moving on to Dr. Karamjit Kaur, how is COVID-19 transmitted, ma'am? I mean, how different are the symptoms in pregnant women? That's one thing that most of our patients have asked in the past week that I have done a research. And are pregnant women more susceptible to COVID, and who are the most at risk, ma'am?
Right. So now coming to the COVID infection, it is again, you know, it's a viral infection. It's a highly infectious disease. So the thing is, we should all know how it is transmitted, because to prevent it, we should know how it's being transmitted so that we can take all the precautions so that one doesn't get infected with COVID-19. So first thing is, it is usually transmitted via aerosol. Like what happens when someone is sitting and coughing, someone who's having a COVID infection, and if the person is coughing or sneezing or talking loudly, what happens is that small water droplets will come out of the mouth, which carry the virus in it. And suppose someone is standing too near to that person, so that person can easily, you know, the virus can get transmitted to that person and then start hovering in that patient. So it can get transmitted through the aerosol, which is generated while coughing or sneezing or talking loudly from a COVID infected person. So that is the most important way how it is getting transmitted. Second way is through contaminated surfaces, wherever we are touching the table, the handrails, the lift. So if some infected person has touched those surfaces and then again someone else is coming and touching that and then, you know, wiping it off in the mouth or in the face, mouth, or touching the eyes and nose with those contaminated hands. So that's the way by which it can get contaminated. So that's why we have to be very careful. That's why the distance thing has come up, that, you know, maintain social distancing. So when you maintain that 1 meter distance, the aerosol, whatever is there, and if you're wearing a mask, you can prevent that transmission happening. So basically transmit through aerosol and through contaminated surface. So that's why wearing the mask and the social distancing is what should be practiced by each and every person whenever they are out. And regarding pregnant women being more susceptible to COVID, Dr. Kavita has already touched on that point. So basically, the pregnant women are not more susceptible. They are as susceptible as any other person who is in the general population. But yes, people who are having more of comorbid conditions along with pregnancies, having diabetes, hypertension, ischemic, any kind of a lung disease, or any kind of a immunocompression, if it is happening, these people will be more susceptible to get the infection, or they might have a severe version of the infection. But as such, in pregnancy, they are as the other population is affected, they are affected the same way. And most of them will just be asymptomatic or have very mild to moderate flu-like symptoms. So we have to just take care of the norms and not panic, first of all.
Okay. Right. Yes, ma'am. Thank you for this information. So viewers, it's not a time to panic, but it's the time, like our doctors say, to stay protected and be careful about what we're doing and how do we take it further. Moving on to the next thing, Kavita ma'am, if you can let us know, are pregnant women more vulnerable for this virus or infection? And do pregnant women generally have breathing issues? Is it so that they have breathing issues, ma'am?
Yes. So we already explained that pregnant women are not very vulnerable, okay, to this virus. But generally, as such, this is the season of flu. Right. And one fortunate thing that's happening in this season is the kids are not going to school. The toddlers are not going to school. So if anybody has got a child at home, generally in this season, we would be seeing a lot of, you know, coughs, colds, running noses in our clinics, including the pregnant women. But fortunately, because everybody is staying home, everybody is taking precautions, we rarely see anybody with cough and cold. Right. So are they more vulnerable for this particular infection? No. So this is because it is also a virus. At the same time, it also spreads very, how Dr. Karamjeet had explained, it spreads. But because everybody is taking precautions, the children are at home, they are not going to school, they're not bringing back anything home. Even the common cough, cold, flu, we are seeing a lot of, you know, they're not there in the clinics anymore. Very few patients, probably they're allergic bronchitis or those kind of patients are only coming to the clinics. So do generally, how do you differentiate, right? I have a regular cough, cold, and do I know whether this is COVID or, you know, should I be worried? I have breathing issues. So every pregnant woman has a breathing issues. It starts right from the day you get pregnant. That's because of the hormones in the first trimester. And coming to the second trimester, then basically it's because the baby is growing, and the third trimester because you don't have any space. So the difference here, from the COVID-19 breathing issues and the breathing issues in pregnancy, is basically we ask everybody to, you know, notice when the breathing issues are persisting. For some of them, it's when they are talking. For some of them, when they are climbing stairs. For some of them, when they are standing for a long period of time. For some of them, it's after food. Right? This is very typical in pregnancy. But whereas in COVID-19, I don't think it will be specifying like, you know, you have breathing issues only when you're walking, talking. It's going to be persistent. And we are also asking many people to buy pulse oximeters to check it at home. So your saturations are being monitored. So if your saturations are very good, anything more than 95%, we are not worried about the breathing issues. But breathing issues are very common in pregnancy. Feeling breathless, okay. That is the feeling. The feeling breathless sensation is very normal in pregnancy. But okay. If you don't have a cough, if you do not have a fever, you do not have any other symptoms like body aches, diarrhea, I don't think you need to be worried.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. To add to that, you know, if Dr. Karamjeet Kaur can tell us that, you know, have you seen any such patients in the recent past with respiratory issues, not COVID, just like that? And then, you know, we have educated them about pulse oximeter, just to add to it, ma'am. Normal during pregnancy and
So it's like, as already discussed, Dr. Kavita has already told that, you know, pregnant women do have this breathing issues on and off sometimes, starting from early pregnancy. Correct. Sometimes they will be feeling more breathless, some, you know, just when they're walking or talking, or sometimes when as the pregnancy advances, the discomfort is there. Basically, that's more of a discomfort, huh? And then some patients might have anemia along in pregnancy, right? So anemia also can lead to some kind of a breathing issues and all. Some people might be having already some kind of they might be asthmatic, or they might be having allergic bronchitis. So all these things, the preconditions patients might be having, plus the pregnancy thing, and plus now the COVID thing has also come in. So basically we need to see and differentiate exactly it is coming from which source, like whether it is from the pregnancy part, or it is from some other pre-existing conditions that she is having, or it's a fresh flu infection, or it is COVID. See, there can be different kind of even respiratory infections also. Every cough and cold might not be COVID. It can be just a normal influenza also. So, you know, we have to just wait, watch. And then if they have more of breathing issues, now every household, I think, have a pulse oximeter. Most of them have purchased a pulse oximeter. They have a thermometer in hand. So, you know, they can monitor themselves at home. And if they feel that, okay, the SpO2 has come down, or they feel they are more breathless, then definitely they have to, you know, report it to their doctor and arrange for a consultation and meet the doctor. So, but then all the breathlessness, all the respiratory issues are not COVID. So that we should first of all take into mind. And then once, you know, it's kind of, we have to opt, okay, see that, okay, this is not because of that, this is not because of this. And then we have to segregate out and then come to a conclusion, or then decide that, okay, this might be some other problem, or the COVID infection thing.
May not be the same. So it is going to be different And in case if there is any issues, and like Kavita ma'am also was specifying that in case pulse oximeter is at home and then you know a certain level and how to take it further, then it's not a cause of concern. Unless
it makes it easier. So, yeah.
Moving on. Yes. Moving on, Dr. Kavita, you know, in pregnancy, like all of us know, there are three important stages: first trimester, second trimester, and the third trimester. In the first trimester itself, you know, what are the effects in the first trimester? And also, you know, what will happen if a person, a mother, is corona positive during this time, ma'am?
Okay. So since the first trimester studies have not yet out, because this virus started only in December, so probably the babies who are all turned positive, pregnant women turning positive in the first trimester, must be delivering somewhere now, and long-term effects till now have not been studied. But the plus point is there is no transplacental crossage of this virus. That means it doesn't cross from the baby to the mother. That's what right now the research is saying that only. But the first trimester effects, whether it is going to affect the fetus in any different way, we will be getting these studies only after probably 6 months to 1 year down the lane. We may not get it very early. For example, the Zika virus, you know about this virus, we came to know only after 1 year when the babies were found to be microcephalic in one clinic after 6 months after birth. Then they realized, yes, there is this virus. They went retrospective and found, yes, this virus causes this kind of problems. So for the COVID, as of now, we have no studies, nothing in the first trimester. But if you test positive in the second trimester or the third trimester, 90% of the times it's the placenta which protects your baby. It doesn't allow the virus to cross and affect the baby. But some of the babies have turned out to be positive at birth also from the mother. So studies are yet to come. The research is yet to happen. As of now, there is no transplacental crossing. That means from the baby, from the mother to the baby in utero, that's inside the uterus, there is no crossage of virus from the mother to the baby. The baby is safe inside, right? So what will be the effects of coronavirus on the baby? As I said, these studies have not yet come. Once the studies come, probably we'll come to know about it, probably 6 months to 1 year down the lane. So we really don't know about them as of now.
Okay, ma'am. All right. Thank you. Ma'am, so it is that we don't have to worry. And if there is something, then the right thing is to consult the doctor and as a patient, follow what the doctor actually has to say. And also, another thing, moving on further, Dr. Karamjeet, we wanted to know any changes in the antenatal care or antenatal plan during this pandemic, and what do we do for hospital visits? What are the stages like? I know that the 12th week of pregnancy, that's the NT scan time, and then we have our anomaly scan, growth scan. So these are certain levels where scans are done, which is a mandatory that we have to visit. However, apart from that also, as a patient, I would want to visit, the hospital and come and consult. So any change in plan during the antenatal visits, ma'am?
Yeah. So pregnancy per se, like patients will have lot many antenatal checkups, some important investigations are to be done, some important scans will be there for the patient. So now the times are slightly different because of the pandemic, which is highly infectious and all. We don't want our patients to come to the hospital for every small things. So right now we just want to minimize their visit to the hospital, and whenever they are coming, so that they can compile most of the things at one go and finish everything and then go back home. So the thing is that initially when they test positive for the pregnancy, they can always have a video consult with the doctor that, okay, doctor, I have tested pregnancy, I missed my periods and it has come out as positive. So, initial that advice to the patient regarding folic acid, regarding their food habits and all those things can be dealt with by the video consult. And we can advise them whatever investigations are required during that video consult itself. So no need to come physically to the hospital as soon as they miss their periods. If they have some kind of an ectopic pregnancy earlier, that's a different issue. But okay. Otherwise, if it's a very normal, healthy pregnancy that has happened, so we can just consult over the video consultation only, and then guide them how to come, when to come. Important physical consultations that are required will be at around 12 to 13 weeks when they do the NT scan along with the double marker test. So that is an important time that the patient has to report to the hospital. And again, at around 5th month when we do the anomaly scanning, at around 28th week when we do another scan for the interval growth scanning and the important blood tests that happen at the time, the sugar test and all, we have to monitor whether the patient's sugars are normal or not, the BP is normal or not. And then again at 36 weeks. So these are the important, you know, so around 12 weeks is something that we have to ask the patient to be there. If they can come, it's very important. 12 weeks, 20 weeks, 28 weeks and 30 weeks. Rest in between, whenever they have any issues or whenever they have any queries or any other small other confusions and any kind of if they want to talk or they want to clear up some confusions and all, they can always connect to us over the video consultations and get things clarified.
Yes,
and yeah, thank you. To do during the hospital visit. So whenever they are coming for the hospital visit, first of all, please always book your appointments when you are coming. Prior only you should book your appointment so that you are not just coming and wasting your time inside the hospital premises. We don't want them to stay for longer time inside the hospital. So if they book the things well ahead, then they will have a time slot where they have to come with the scan stands, finish the blood test, see their consultant and go back home. So prior booking the appointment is a very good thing. They should always book the appointments, get all their papers, get all their documents, whatever they have to come along with them to the hospital. Note down what they need to ask to the doctor so that they don't have to again and again, revert back, or they don't spend too much of time in the consultation room. So note down the questions that you have in hand. Then finish your scanning, see the doctor, whatever immunization is required, finish up that, and then maintain the social distancing and then go back home. So once they're back home, they should again wash their hands, change, and then have a bath. So this is something which is very important. Yeah. So these are the few things that they should be doing when they are coming for the consultation.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Moving on to further, with similar grounds itself, I wanted to know from Kavita, ma'am, what are the expectations between 18 and 20 weeks, and since already ma'am was telling about 12 to 18 weeks what we can do, so what are the expectations between 12 to 14 weeks one and then 18 to 20 weeks, ma'am?
So every pregnant woman's question is the same now. They must be going through, I used to see my doctor every now and then before. The comfort of meeting the doctor for the 9 months, it's like pregnancy is totally a different story. It's not like regular patients who come, finish their problem and then go. Here is the doctor, the hospital, the customer care, everybody, it becomes like a family. 9 months, they come, they see you, they'll be seeing you multiple times. So that generally happens in pregnancy. But now we are asking them not to come to the hospitals many times. And there's a lot of apprehension in the patients. So as Dr. Karamjit rightly pointed out, when you want to reach us, we are always there on the video consults. You can always call the hospital. We are there to help you out. But certain times it's necessary for you to come to the hospital. So that's when we need to do our scans. We cannot miss the crucial moments of pregnancy. That's getting your NT scan done, where we try to diagnose whether you have any chances of having a Down syndrome baby. So that happens in the hospital. And it's a very specialized ultrasound. So that happens between 12 to 14 weeks, where you have to come, get your bloods done for double marker test and get your nuchal translucency scan done. This is to diagnose any chances of having a Down syndrome, whether you are in the higher risk or lower risk for it. That's what we are trying to look here. And then coming to 18 to 20 weeks, fortunately, now we can try to push it at 20 weeks. We would want you to come at 20 weeks for two reasons. One is for, again, the anomaly scan or the targeted scan, where we check the baby from top to bottom to see any physical defects, any other problems, what's the blood supply to the baby, any other concerns which we have, where's the placenta located, how is your baby growing. From 12 to 20 weeks, this is the only thing which we do. 20 weeks is an anomaly scan. Again, a very important milestone for all of you, just to see your baby back again and also to ascertain whether this baby is good enough to go ahead, right? And we also vaccinate you during that time at 20 weeks. Generally, we start vaccinations as early as 12 weeks, but we don't prefer to do that because all of you are, hygienic, and until and unless you have a cut or you've cut yourself with a knife or anything rusty, we don't call you for any vaccinations early. So we integrate it along with your anomaly scan at 20 weeks. So you will be vaccinated for tetanus and diphtheria at that point of time. And also you finish your anomaly scan. And the most important point which I would like to touch upon is, then why was the doctor calling me so many times in my first pregnancy and this doctor really doesn't want to see me now? It's not because you're going to give me something or I'm going to give you a corona or a COVID. It's not like that. If possible, the rules have been made, right? If possible, the government or the guidelines say, if possible, if you do not need to see the patient at that point of time, try to communicate through the digital media or the video consultation. That would be much better rather than bringing you all the way to the hospital. Certain times, yes, if you have bleeding, spotting, any kind of things which we cannot help you through the video consult, we'll be calling to the hospital. Otherwise, these are the situations when you need to come to the hospital. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. So rightly said by ma'am that, we are all so connected with an obstetrician that from the day one that I know that my, I'm positive, pregnancy positive, and I feel that I should keep consulting the doctor many, many times and understand how things are for every small little doubt. So all our patients, we are available on video consultations for all small little doubts and queries that are there. And then our doctors are very much, helpful in that way. From 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. at any given point in time, we are very much available. And kindly get in touch with us so that all the doubts sitting at home safe will be answered and would be taken care as well. Moving on further, ma'am, there's a live question one of our viewers are asking. My wife is, what if my wife is pregnant and she's found COVID positive? Can she be cured from it?
Viral infections, they have a cycle, right? So according to the studies which we have found recently about the COVID, even though we are still researching into it, so we say this will stay inside the body for 10 to 14 days and afterwards you are cured of it, basically. So but there are certain instances, very few instances, where patients have also reported that even after 3 weeks or 4 weeks they've turned out, they're still being positive. So there may be two reasons for it: a reinfection, which they are still studying whether the reinfection is possible or not. The second thing is shedding of the dead virus. That can also be possible when we do the test and she can still be positive. But generally, if anybody, that's why the government says less than 34 weeks. If a pregnant woman is still positive, they can still stay home, self-isolate. After 2 weeks, we repeat the test. That means that after 2 weeks, she's supposed to be negative. So if she does not have any symptoms, if she's asymptomatic, as most 80% of our patients are asymptomatic, so you don't have to worry about this. She will, after 14 days, everything will be taken care of.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. We'll keep coming up with so many questions that are there, which is popping up shortly in a while. Moving on to Karamjeet, ma'am. Ma'am, what are the milestones, like we just spoke about it some time ago, in gestational, weeks, which can I avoid in terms of visiting, and what can I do for video consultation? So let's say 8th week, 12th week, and 14th and 18th, so on and so forth. When should I ideally visit the hospital? One. And when should I go ahead with video consultation? How can I manage between the two?
See, generally in pregnancy, during the first trimester, we would like to see the patient weekly till they are 28 weeks. From thereafter, it is every two weeks, and after 36 weeks, it is weekly. But now, because of this pandemic thing which is going on, we don't want them to be in the hospital for a longer time, or when there is not there are issues which can be sorted out over a teleconsultation, we don't want them to come here, so that the chances of them getting the infection will be less. So the time when we can avoid our patients, we can just deal with their queries or over the teleconsultation will be around, early pregnancy, as we have already discussed. As soon as they get, they have their missed periods, they can have a teleconsultation, and whatever confusion is in their mind, they can always clear their doubts, and whatever prescription about folic acid and if any multivitamins are required, all those things can be prescribed at that time. Second thing is at around 12 weeks they have to come to the hospital because for scannings, you know, it's not possible at with tele or whatever other ways and all. So for scanning, they have to report to the hospital and finish the scanning, and that time they can have their physical meet with the doctor. Again, at around 16 weeks, they can, because there will be a lot of confusion, there will be a lot of, you know, there will be in a lot of doubts actually all the time, whether I should do this, do that, this is happening to me, is this right or not, I don't know, there's no one to guide me at home also, I don't, my mother is not here. So many things are there now. So at 14 weeks, 14 to 16 weeks, again, usually we would like to see them, but then now because of the current scenario, yes, if they have no other, you know, other issues and all, we can always connect over the video consultations. But again, 20 weeks, they need to report. 24, again, we can have a video consultations. But the thing is that they should have a facility to check their weight and BP at home. So they should, you know, at least keep on checking their weight and blood pressure on and off around 10 to 15 days interval or 1 month interval in the first few months of pregnancy, so that when they are not reporting to the hospital, at least we will know the status of their, you know, blood pressure and sugar levels and all those things. Then again, coming to 7 months, ma'am, definitely they have to report for scanning and immunization. 32 to 34 weeks, again, we can have a video consultation, and then whatever they have doubts or confusions, can we can deal with that. And but 36 weeks, again, they have to be back. So the important times, 12, 20, 28, and 36, they have to report. Other times, if they are not a high-risk patient, if they have no other, you know, they don't have diabetes or hypertension, then maybe we can consult over the video, we can connect over the video thing and all. But then if they have diabetes, if they have hypertension, and if there is a need that we need to see them, that is not a criteria that they should stay at home. If there is a need, they should be reporting to the hospital. If there is any bleeding, if there is any leaking, or if they feel the movements are less, or any other issues which is actually worrying them, so, and they feel that, that they need to see a doctor, we are always there for them. But then wherever, if it is not very urgent and if it's just some confusion, always you can connect over the phone.
Okay, all right. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for that. Moving on to Kavita, ma'am. Ma'am, a lot of our viewers are requesting you know, you to talk in Kannada, and they want to know a couple of other things. Sure. So, thing is that you know, ನಮ್ಮ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರಿಗಾದ್ರೂ ನಮ್ಮ ಬಂಧುಗೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ನಮ್ಮ ಗೊತ್ತಿರೋರಿಗೆ ಯಾರಿಗಾದ್ರೂ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಆಗಿ ನಾವು ಮನೇಲಿ ಇದ್ದಾಗ ನಾವು ಆ ಒಂದು ಸಿಚುವೇಶನ್ ನ ಹೇಗ್ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು? ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ಆಗಿದ್ದೀನಿ ಅಂತಂದಾಗ ಕೆಲವೊಂದ್ ಟೈಮ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನನ್ನ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ತಗೊಳ್ಳಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿರ್ತಾರೆ, ನನ್ಗೆ ಯಾರಾದ್ರೂ ಒಬ್ರು ಊಟ ತಂದ್ಕೊಡೋರು ಇರ್ಬೇಕು ಅಥವಾ ಏನೋ ಒಂದ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತಿದ್ದಾಗ ಅದನ್ನ ನಾವ್ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಹ್ಯಾಂಡಲ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಮ್ಯಾಮ್?
ಸೊ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಗವರ್ನಮೆಂಟ್ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದೆ, ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ ಆ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್. ಇಫ್ ಪಾಸಿಬಲ್ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಟೈಮ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದು ನೋಡಿ, ಅದು ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ಲಿ ಡಿಮಾರ್ಕೇಟೆಡ್ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ವುಮೆನ್ 36 ವೀಕ್ ತನಕ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅವರೇ ಮಾನಿಟರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬಹುದು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅವರು ಏನಾದ್ರು ಹೆಂಗ್ ಸಿಂಪ್ಟಮ್ಸ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಯಾವಾಗ ಅವ್ರ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಹತ್ರ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು, ಅಂಡ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಹತ್ರ ಕನೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಇದಾರಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಪೇಷಂಟ್, ಎಲ್ಲ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಒಂದ್ಸಲ ಓದಿ, ತುಂಬಾ ಸರ್ಪ್ರೈಸಿಂಗ್ ದ ವೇ ದ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬೀನ್ ಗಿವನ್, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ವೆರಿ ವೆಲ್ ಡನ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ರೀಡ್ ದ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಗವರ್ನಮೆಂಟ್ ಗೈಡ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್, ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಓದಿ, ಅದು ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ. ಸೊ ನಾವು ಸಪೋಸ್ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ವುಮೆನ್ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅವರು ಲೆಸ್ ದನ್ 34 ವೀಕ್ಸ್ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಈಗ 34 ವೀಕ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಇದೆ, ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲೇ ಇರ್ಬೋದು. ಓಕೆ, ಅವರು ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಬರೋ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಬಟ್ ಏನಂದ್ರೆ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಒಂದು ಕಿಟ್ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ, ನೀವು ರೈನ್ಬೋ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಕಾಲ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು, ಇಲ್ಲ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಕಾಲ್ ಎನಿ ಆಫ್ ಯುವರ್ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್, ಅವ್ರು ನಿಮ್ಗೊಂದು ಕಿಟ್ ಮನೆಗೆ ಕಳಿಸ್ತಾರೆ. ಆ ಕಿಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮ್ಗೊಂದು ಪಲ್ಸ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಮೀಟರ್ ಸಿಗತ್ತೆ, ಒಂದು ಥರ್ಮೋಮೀಟರ್ ಸಿಗತ್ತೆ, ಯಾವಾಗ ಅಂಡ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಕಂದು ಏನು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ಗೆ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಕನ್ಸಲ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ಕೇನು ಒಂದು, ಇಲ್ಲಾಂದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಷನಲ್ ನಿಮ್ ಜೊತೆ ಡೈಲಿ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಕನ್ಸಲ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ಕೇನು ಅವರೆಲ್ಲ ಆಪರ್ಚುನಿಟಿ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ. ಸೊ ಏನಾಗತ್ತೆ, ನೀವು ಮೇನ್ ಆಗಿ ಡೈಲಿ ಒಂದು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಆಕ್ಸಿಜನ್ ಸ್ಯಾಚುರೇಷನ್ಸ್ ನೋಡ್ತೀರಾ, ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ನೋಡ್ತೀರಾ, ಒಂದ್ 3-4 ಅವರ್ಸ್ ಒಂದ್ಸಲ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ಗೆ ಅಪ್ಡೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತೀರಾ, ಒಂದ್ ನಂಬರ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರ್ತಾರೆ ಆ ನಂಬರ್ಗೆ ನೀವು ಅಪ್ಡೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತೀರಾ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಾದ್ರು ತೊಂದ್ರೆ ಇದ್ರೆ, ಸಿಂಪ್ಟಮ್ಸ್ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರೆ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ನಿಮ್ನ ದೇ ವಿಲ್ ಗೈಡ್, ಅವರೇ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬರ್ಬೇಕು, ಇಲ್ಲ ಈ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಈ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು, ತುಂಬಾ ಸಿವಿಯರ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಆರ್ ದೇ ವಿಲ್ ಗೈಡ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಯುವರ್ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಟು ಇಟ್. ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಜನ ಇದ್ವಿ ನಾವು, ಬಟ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಆಗಲ್ಲ, ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು ಆ ಟೈಮಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಆಪ್ಷನ್ ಇಲ್ಲ. ನೀವು ಕಂಪಲ್ಸರಿ ವೆಲ್ ವೆಂಟಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ಇರೋ ಬಾತ್ರೂಮ್ ಇರೋ ರೂಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ನೀವು ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ನಿಮ್ ಬೆಡ್ರೂಮ್ಗೆ ಅಟ್ಯಾಚ್ಡ್ ಬಾತ್ರೂಮ್ ಇರಬೇಕು. ಬೇರೆ ಯಾರಾದ್ರೂ ನೀವು ಒಬ್ಬರೇ ಇದ್ರೆ ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫೈನ್, ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾರಾದ್ರೂ ಊಟ ತಂದ್ ಮಾಡು ತಂದು ಕೊಟ್ಬಿಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ಇಲ್ಲಾಂದ್ರೆ ನೀವೇ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ನೀವು ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಹತ್ರ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಹತ್ರ ಬರಬಾರ್ದು ಪ್ಲೀಸ್. ನೀವು ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸಿಂಗ್ ಮಾಡ್ಲೇಬೇಕು ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ, ಇಲ್ಲಾಂದ್ರೆ ಈ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇರೋರು ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡತ್ತೆ. ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಆತರ ಆಗ್ಲಿಲ್ಲ, ದನ್ ಐ ಕೆ ನಾಟ್ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮೈ ಹೌಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಫುಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಅನ್ನುವಾಗ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಗೋ ಟು ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್, ಹತ್ರ ಇರೋ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಹೋಗಿ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ. ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಅವ್ರು ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ, ಆಲ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಅವ್ರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ರೈಟ್, ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿರುವಾಗ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಈ ಫೆಸಿಲಿಟೀಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇದ್ರೆ ಮಾತ್ರನೇ ವೆಲ್ ವೆಂಟಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ರೂಮ್, ಎಲ್ಲ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಏರ್ ಸನ್ಲೈಟ್ ಬರೋ ರೂಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸಪರೇಟ್ ಬೆಡ್ರೂಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಬಾತ್ರೂಮ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಮಾತ್ರನೇ ನೀವು ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ನೀವು ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ಗೆ ಬಂದು ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು. ಇದು ತುಂಬಾ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. ನೇಬರ್ ಇದೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಪಕ್ಕದ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗಿದೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ನನ್ನ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ತುಂಬಾ ಮುದುಕರು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ನೀವು ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇರೋದ್ ಬೇಡಿ ಆ ಟೈಮಲ್ಲಿ. ತುಂಬಾ ಏಜ್ಡ್ ಅವ್ರ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ರೆ ನೀವು ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಸೇವ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ಕೆ ನೀವು ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಬರೋದು ಒಳ್ಳೇದು. ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗಿ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದು ತುಂಬಾ ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್, ಅದು ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ವೇ ಆಫ್ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ನೇಬರ್ಗಿದೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಸೊ ಯು ಟ್ರೈ ಟ್ರೇಸಿಂಗ್, ಅವ್ರ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮ್ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದೇ ಮೇಡ್ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಶೇರಿಂಗ್ ಎನಿಥಿಂಗ್, ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ನೋಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಸ್ಟೇ ಅವೇ, ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ. ಸೊ ದಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಮೇನ್ ಥಿಂಗ್, ಅವರು ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ಅವರು ರೂಲ್ಸ್ ಫಾಲೋ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ನೀವು ರೂಲ್ಸ್ ಫಾಲೋ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಮೇಕ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಕಿಟ್ಸ್, ಅವ್ರು ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ. ನೀವು ಈ ತರ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಬಂದ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಹಾಸ್ಪಿಟಲ್ ಫೋನ್ ಮಾಡಿ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ, ಅವ್ರ ಮನೆಗೆ ಕಳಿಸ್ತಾರೆ ಒಂದು ಪಿಪಿಇ ಕಿಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹಾಕೊಂಡು, ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ, ಎಲ್ಲ ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಮಾನಿಟರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ಎಷ್ಟು ಗಂಟೆಗೆ ಒಂದ್ಸಲ ಮಾನಿಟರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ಏನ್ ತೊಂದರೆ ಇದ್ರೇನು ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಕನ್ಸಲ್ಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ.
ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ನೀವ್ ಹೇಳೋ ಪ್ರಕಾರ 34 ವಾರಗಳ ತನಕ ನಾವು ಮನೆಯಿಂದ ಆಚೆ ಬರೋಂತ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಒಂದ್ ವೇಳೆ ನಾವು ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಆಗಿದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು. ಮತ್ತೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಆಸ್ಪತ್ರೆನಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಕಾಲ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಯಾವುದೇ ಒಂದು ಆಸ್ಪತ್ರೆನಲ್ಲಾಗ್ಲಿ ಕಾಲ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಈ ತರ ಇದೆ ಅಂತಂದಾಗ ಬಂದು ಆ ಒಂದು ಗೈಡೆನ್ಸ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ಅದಾದ ನಂತರ ಹೇಗೆ ಮಾನಿಟರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನ ಕೂಡ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಮತ್ತೊಂದು ವಿಷಯ ಏನು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಅಕ್ಕಪಕ್ಕ, ಇದು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದಂತ ವಿಚಾರ ಮೇಡಮ್ ಹೇಳಿರೋದಂತದ್ದು, ಅಕ್ಕಪಕ್ಕ ಮನೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ್ದಾದ್ರು ಕಾಮನ್ ಜನ ಓಡಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದಾರೆ, ಕೆಲ್ಸದವ್ರು ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ಅಥವಾ ಹಾಲ್ ಹಾಕೋನ್ ಬರ್ತಾನೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಏನೋ ಒಂದಕ್ಕೆ ಯಾವ್ದೋ ಕಾರಣಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಅಕ್ಕಪಕ್ಕದವರು ಏನಕ್ಕೂ ಬಂದು ಹೋಗಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂತ ಒಂದು ಕಾಮನ್ ಜನಾಂಗ ಯಾರು ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂತ ಇರುತ್ತೋ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ, ಅವರಿಂದ ನೀವು ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನ ದೂರ ಇಟ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ ಆಗಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಗೊತ್ತಿದ್ದಾಗ. ನಮ್ ಸಮಾಜದಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ಇವಾಗ ನಾವ್ ಒಂದು ಅಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಇಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು ಫ್ಲಾಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಏನೇ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಸುಮಾರು ಜನ ಒಂದೇ ಒಂದು ಒಂದು ವೃತ್ತಿಲಿ ಇರೋರು ಸುಮಾರು ಜನಕ್ಕೆ ಸಹಾಯ ಮಾಡಂತವ್ರು ಇರ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅಲ್ಲಿಗೆ ನಾವ್ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನ ನಾವು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಇರ್ಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತಂತದ್ದು. ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಏನ್ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ಮೇಡಮ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಟಾಯ್ಲೆಟ್ ಇರಂತ ಒಂದು ಅಟ್ಯಾಚ್ಡ್ ಬಾತ್ರೂಮ್ ಇರಂತ ಒಂದು ರೂಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನಮ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಅನ್ನ ಐಸೋಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು. ವಯಸ್ಸಾದವರು ಸಣ್ಣ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಇರಂತ ಜಾಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಂಜಾಗ್ರತೆ ತಗೊಳ್ಳೋದು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಮ್ಯಾಮ್, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್. ಮೂವಿಂಗ್ ಆನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಫರ್ದರ್ ಯುನೋ, ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಕರಂಜಿತ್, ವಿ ವುಡ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಟು ನೋ ದಟ್ ಯುನೋ ಹೌ ಡು ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾಂಡಲ್ ಎನಿ ಪ್ರಿಕಾಷನ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಲೈಫ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್. ಏಕ್ ಹಮಾರೇ ಕಸ್ಟಮರ್ ಪೇಷಂಟ್ ಹೈ ಜೋ ಬೋಲ್ ರಹೇ ಕಿ ಕೋಯಿ ಪ್ರಿಕಾಷನ್ಸ್ ಲೇನಾ ಹೈ, ಕೋಯಿ ಸಪ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಲೇನಾ ಹೈ, ಲೈಕ್ ವಿಟಮಿನ್ ಸಿ ಟ್ಯಾಬ್ಲೆಟ್ಸ್ ಹೋ ಯಾ ಇಮ್ಯೂನಿಟಿ ಬಡಾನೆ ಕೆ ಲಿಯೆ ಐಸಾ ಕುಚ್ ಚೀಜ್ ಹೈ ಜೋ ಹಮೆ ಕರ್ನಾ ಹೈ ಮ್ಯಾಮ್?
बेसिकली क्या है कि यदि कोई भी इन्फेक्शन हो तो उसमें हमारे हर हर चीज के लिए दवाई की जरूरत नहीं होती है. सबसे पहले हमारे बॉडी में हमारी अंदरूनी ताकत होती है जो लड़ती है उस चीज के साथ में. सो फर्स्ट थिंग दैट वी हैव टू सी इज दैट हमारी अंदर की जो ताकत है वो हमारा जो इम्यूनिटी है दैट इज स्ट्रांग. सो इम्यूनिटी कैसे स्ट्रांग बनेगी, वो बनेगी अच्छे खाने के साथ, अच्छे रेस्ट के साथ, अच्छा पानी पी रहे हो, अपने आप को हाइड्रेटेड रख रहे हो. तो ये चीज सबसे पहले इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है कि आपका गुड डाइट होना चाहिए. सेकेंड थिंग इज यू शुड एक्सरसाइज, यू शुड डू सम योगा, प्राणायाम वगैरह करे, ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइजेस करे. यू शुड स्लीप वेल, ज्यादा स्ट्रेस ना ले. ज्यादा टीवी देखेंगे, ज्यादा न्यूज देखेंगे तो ऐसे ही वो जब जब देखते रहेंगे तो उनका और बहुत सारी विचार दिमाग में आते हैं जिससे कि उनका बहुत लोगों का मानसिक संतुलन भी बिगड़ सकता है. तो बेसिकली ये है कि आप ज्यादा टीवी ना देखें, आप थोड़ा सा मेडिटेट करें, योगा करें, आप अच्छा खाना खाएं, अच्छा पानी पिए, अच्छा सोए, अच्छे लोगों से पॉजिटिव बातें करें. एक बहुत पॉजिटिव एटीट्यूड रखना इज ऑल्सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. सो अपने आप को हमेशा पॉजिटिव रखें. ये मत सोचे कि क्या हो जाएगा, ये हो गया वो हो गया, वैसा नहीं। अपने आप को हमेशा पॉजिटिव रखें। और दूसरी चीज है कि मल्टीविटामिन्स, अगर आप अच्छा खाना खा रहे हैं, अगर आप अच्छे फ्रूट खा रहे हैं, अच्छे वेजिटेबल्स सब खा रहे हैं, तो एक्स्ट्रा चीजों की वैसे जरूरत नहीं होती है। ओनली जिन लोगों को डिफिशियंसी होती है, जिनका खाना में कॉम्प्रोमाइज है, उनको ही विटामिन सप्लीमेंट्स की जरूरत पड़ती है। ऐसे हर किसी को वैसे कोई जरूरत नहीं है। तो बस मेन यही चीजों का ख्याल रखना है कि आप अपना खाना ठीक से खाएंगे, आप सोशल डिस्टेंस मेंटेन करेंगे, जब भी आप बाहर जाएं हमेशा 6 फीट की दूरी रखिए, लोगों से ज्यादा मिलना नहीं है, किसी को अपने घर बुलाना नहीं है, ज्यादा मार्केट जाने की जरूरत नहीं है, जहाँ पे भी कोई जैसे कि जिसको हम अवॉइड कर सकते हैं, मॉल जाना, मार्केट जाना, कोई सोशल गैदरिंग, शादी हो गई, अभी प्रेगनेंसी में कोई ज्यादा जरूरत नहीं है कि आपको शादियां जाके अटेंड करनी है, बिकॉज नाउ सेफ्टी इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। सो बेसिकली अब ये है कि प्रेगनेंसी चल रही है तो हमें अपना ख्याल रखना है, हमें भीड़ वाली जगह में नहीं जाना है, अगर कहीं जाने की जरूरत है तो हमने मास्क पहनना है, मास्क भी जब हम पहनते हैं तो हमें उसे सही तरीके से पहनना है। कभी कभी मास्क क्या होता है, नॉस्ट्रल के नीचे होता है, कभी कभी गले में लटक रहा होता है, तो मास्क को सही प्रकार से पहनना बहुत ज्यादा जरूरी है कि वो आपका नोज और माउथ को पूरी तरह से कवर करे और आप बार बार उसे छूते ना रहे। अगर आप उसे बार बार छूते रहेंगे तो आप इन्फेक्शन जो है आप अपनी तरफ आकर्षित कर रहे हैं। तो आपको मास्क को बार बार नहीं छूना है, आपको अच्छी तरीके से मास्क पहनना है, उसे डिस्पोज करना भी एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है कि आपका जब मास्क यूज हो गया तो इट शुड गो डायरेक्टली टू द बिन, आप उसको यहाँ वहां कहीं पे भी घर पे मत रखिए ऐसे। और दूसरी बात यह है कि प्रैक्टिस हैंड हाइजीन, मतलब हाथ को सही तरीके से धोना है। कभी भी आपने कुछ टच किया है या आपको लगा कि हाथ गंदे हो गए या बाहर से अंदर आए हैं, तो प्रॉपर हैंड वॉशिंग इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। 20 सेकेंड्स ऑफ हैंड वॉशिंग विद प्रॉपर सोप इज इनफ टू किल द वायरस। ऐसा नहीं है कि आपको बार बार सैनिटाइजर से ही अपने आपको ना उससे स्किन ड्राई भी हो जाती है, एंड प्लस द नॉर्मल बैक्टीरिया हमारे स्किन की वो भी निकल जाती है। तो सैनिटाइजर हर वक्त जरूरत नहीं है। आप अगर साबुन और पानी भी इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं और अच्छी तरीके से धो रहे हैं तो उतना ही काफी है। तो बेसिकली मास्क पहनना है अगर आप बाहर जा रहे हैं, दूसरा हैंड वॉश करना है, लोगों से दूरी बनाए रखनी है, अच्छा खाना पानी पीना है, अच्छा सोना है, अपना प्राणायाम करना है, योगा करना है। अगर आप इतना कर रहे हैं तो आई थिंक दिस इज मोर देन सफिशियंट।
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, थैंक यू मैम, थैंक यू सो मच। ये चीजें बहुत जरूरी होती है जो करमजीत मैम बता रही है हम सब लोगों को, कि हमें अपने आप को प्रेगनेंसी के वक्त थोड़ा सा आइसोलेट करना अच्छी बात है। गैदरिंग्स में हर कोई सब टाइम में जा सकता है, बट ये एक पैंडेमिक का एरा जो है, इस वक्त अगर हम अपने आप के लिए और आने वाले हमारे बच्चे के लिए अगर हम प्रिकॉशंस ले सकते हैं और बाहर ना जाए अनलेस एंड अनटिल रिक्वायर्ड, तो बहुत अच्छी बात होगी। थैंक यू मैम, थैंक यू सो मच। कविता मैम, देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम वन ऑफ आवर यू नो पेशेंट्स, एंड दे से दैट आई हैव बीन सीइंग मैम फॉर अ वेरी लॉन्ग टाइम नाउ, एंड यू नो आई नो दैट शी ऑलवेज गाइड्स अस इन टर्म्स ऑफ व्हाट वी नीड टू डू एंड हाउ वी नीड टू टेक केयर। आई ओनली हैव वन डाउट, दैट इज शुड आई यूज मास्क ऑल द टाइम व्हाइल आई एम एट होम ऑल्सो। ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇರುವಾಗ ಯಾವಾಗಲೂ ನಾನು ಮಾಸ್ಕ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾ, ಇಲ್ಲ ಓಡಾಡಬಹುದ ಹಾಗೇನೆ ಉಸಿರಾಟಕ್ಕೆ ತೊಂದರೆ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮ್ಯಾಮ್?
ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ನೋ, ಯು ಡೋಂಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಯೂಸ್ ದ ಮಾಸ್ಕ್ ವೆನ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಎಟ್ ಹೋಮ್, ಬಟ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಅ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಪೇಷಂಟ್, ಸಪೋಸ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್, ದೆನ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಸಪೋಸ್ ಟು ವೇರ್ ಅ ಮಾಸ್ಕ್ ಟು ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟ್ ಅದರ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಇಟ್, ರೈಟ್? ಬಟ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಯು ಡೋಂಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ವೇರ್ ಅ ಮಾಸ್ಕ್ ಎಟ್ ಹೋಮ್, ರೈಟ್? ಬಟ್ ಈವನ್ ಎಟ್ ಹೋಮ್ ಐ ವುಡ್ ಪ್ರಿಫರ್ ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್. It can be at home also. Please do not sit, all of you sitting together all the time. Unfortunately, one of them could have picked it up and come home when you're buying your groceries or when you're talking to your milkman, or as you rightly pointed, maids. One of you can turn positive, but why should you give it to everybody at home, isn't it? So social distance is going to be there even at home. Please sit a little away from each other. I know all that hugging and all that stuff with your children and all. Stay a little away from your children, but wearing masks at home is not compulsory. If you are positive, then yes, you have to wear your mask all the time, right? For pregnant women, yeah, it is very difficult to wear a mask all the time because they become very breathless. So you only have a little bit of lenience if you are in the bathroom or anywhere where you can do it. I mean, you have a very long distance from the other person, but if you are at home and if you are positive, you need to wear your mask to protect your family. But if you are not positive, then you don't have to wear a mask.
Okay, ma'am. One more question which has come up: do we have to perform all the growth scans? Most important scans that are required, what are they?
Okay. See, basically, everybody must be wondering, so I'm able to manage my pregnancy so well, so why are the doctors calling me so many times? Unfortunately, Dr. Karamjit haven't made these rules. So these rules have been there from the beginning. That means to see a patient at the booking visit, that is at 7 weeks, and then looking at her at 12, 16, 20, 24, 28, all this have been as guidelines. So we have not invented them anytime. The growth scans per se also have been given by books, right? These are guidelines. So you follow them, like 28 weeks, you need one growth scan. And suppose I find a problem there, then I may even call you after 2 weeks. If I don't see any issues, I see the baby growing very well, the growth percentiles are fine, the chart looks very good for us, then we will call you back only at 36 to 38 weeks for the next growth scan. Otherwise, we don't need to do any scans in between. But if we find something abnormal, even at 20 weeks, then we call you back even at 24 weeks, right? We need to look at it. That's called the first growth scan. So we may even call you at that point of time. We may call you at 28 back again. It depends on the first scan or the risk category in which you are. Suppose you are a high-risk pregnancy, we are not very comfortable with one scan, then we may call you for multiple scans. But as such, if you are the general population, that's 90% of the pregnant women we feel are normal. If that is the case, physiologically, we don't have any issues, pathologically, then we call you according to, 28 to 30 weeks, we get one growth scan, and 36 to 38 weeks, we get one growth scan. That is compulsory because, I would always tell my patients only one thing. My father and mother would never see a flight. They my grandfather used to go by a bullock cart, but medicine is fortunately or unfortunately changing drastically. We go more by diagnostics, a blind way of touching your tummy and saying everything is fine. When you have a wonderful ultrasound machine sitting next to you and an expertise doctor sitting there and telling me and looking into your baby and telling me everything is fine, gives me more confidence rather than not doing anything about it.
Ma'am, one more question. I am pregnant and a healthcare worker. So basically, this person says she's a healthcare worker. Can I work with patients who are potentially infected with COVID-19, ma'am?
If you're pregnant and if you're a healthcare worker, this is a personal choice. There is nothing, as I said, if you're pregnant, it does not mean that you're going to have an increase or you're more vulnerable to it. But wearing a PPE, wearing your masks for 12 hours without passing urine, without eating in time, is going to be very, very difficult for you, right? So you need to please inform your whoever is in charge of your ward or in charge of your work there. It's important to tell them that you're pregnant because you may be inviting other things. You may be having a urinary tract infection because you've not passed urine, because you cannot remove your PPE in between. They're very expensive. You can't just remove PPE every 2 hours and say, no, I have to pass urine or I have to eat. So you need to make a personal choice here. I would definitely prefer not doing the things you should have your very small role in that. Probably do direct contact. I would not be very appreciable about it because wearing a PPE for so long in a pregnancy is really, really a difficult task. At one point or the other, you will want to give it up, and I don't want you to be lax at any point, right? So if you're lax at any given point of time, you are inviting the disease to yourself. You need to take care of yourself. That's very important. So talking to your seniors about it or talking to other professionals, who are taking care of that particular patient is very important, and telling them, letting them know that you're pregnant is very important. There are lots of practical problems involved.
Correct. True. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Moving on to another one question that's come up, Dr. Karamjit, if you can let us know that I am, I have delivered a baby 4 days ago and I have symptoms of cold and cough and headache. Do I, consult or is it COVID? Should I stop feeding?
The patient having delivered 4 days back and having cold, cough and headache.
Fever, ma'am. Fever. And headache. Yes, cold, cough, fever, and headache. And can I feed my baby is one other question.
Right. See, feeding the baby, even if you are having any symptoms, the main thing is that we should not be transmitting. That's the thing. Okay, any kind of infection. See, it can be influenza also, it can be COVID also, we don't know. But the thing is, any kind of an infection, if we take proper precautions while feeding the baby, suppose if you are wearing proper mask, if you're doing proper hand hygiene and then feeding the baby where the contact time is very less and all, that's fine. But otherwise, what they can do is they can express the milk. They can do the proper hand hygiene, wear the mask, express the milk, and that milk can be fed to the baby through a palada. Via spoon, or say, you know, via spoon, the baby can be fed. The baby can be kept separate from the mother, and the milk can be expressed from the mother with proper hand hygiene and a mask, and that milk can be fed to the baby through a palada. So that is the best thing that can be done when a patient is having any kind of an infection and where she is actually suspecting that she might be having the COVID. So we don't know at that point whether she has a COVID or not, because the test has to be done. But then till that time, she can always practice this, because even if though she is positive, this is the thing that that will be advised to the patient, that, you know, you have to keep your distance from the baby and let some other healthy person take care of the baby, and regarding the bread, milk and all. So, you know, just express it and then pass it on so that it can be fed to the baby in a very sterile condition.
Okay, all right. So I would also add to this that in case if there is a doubt and you know, there is a concern that is bothering a new born baby's mother, please consult us through video consultation first to clear out all your doubts and to ease you know, the discomfort or the kind of stress level that you're going through, because it's very important that you consult us, you know, your doctors as patients, and follow them. That's you know, do a video consultation, very important. And one just to you know, before we could wind up, Kavita ma'am, there's a lot of you know, social stigma when you're positive and when you come back home after the treatment and you're okay, or when you know that you're positive and all, and especially during pregnancy already, you know, I'm with a mixed bag of emotions, so many things running in my mind and holding the baby and, you know, everything that's happening. How do we address this, ma'am? What do we do to, you know, address this situation?
The first rule or the first saying from everybody, be it the government of India or the WHO or anybody, do not stigmatize a patient. So there is, you should never stigmatize a patient, or you should never stigmatize a person who's turned out to be positive. But as I said, after 14 days, she's going to be negative. So there's nothing that you're going to be worried about. So there is, of course, there's a lot of stigma that is because of the rumors and the misconception that, you know, they're positive and they'll be positive forever. I say, and they can keep transmitting the virus, you know, for a long period of time. Once the patient has turned negative, then you don't have to worry about it. Okay. Fortunately, most of my patients, or the few patients which we have done and we have seen, as you know, the husbands have been very, very supportive. They've been with the patients in the same room. They've taken care of the patients very well. They've given, taken care of their wives very well. So when a person, the other person is inside and they're taking care of, and we are, when we are also going and taking care of the patients, my nurses are taking care of the patients. It is just, we are taking our precautions for ourselves. Just take precautions, that's all. But there's no stigma involved in it. You should never stigmatize a person. Right, so it is, the virus is going to go away another 2 weeks. It's like, you know, its life cycle is done and it is going to shed and it is going to go away. It has no use for your body after that. So there is no point in stigmatizing anybody, right? So please, I would add up one point to what Karamjit was saying about breastfeeding. So kindly wash your breast if you're if you're doubtful. Just wash your breast before you try to express or something, which we generally would not, you know, regularly suggest for normal women. Kindly wash your breast before you try to pump out or you feed, and a mask is a must. And the most important thing, if you are doubtful, please get yourself tested. Test, test, and test is what the whole world is talking about, testing. Please do not sit at home and think that it's okay, I just have a common cough, cold, or flu. Kindly go to the hospital and get yourself tested. It's okay if we prove that you're negative, but if you're positive, there are certain things which we would want for you, for the baby, and for the family. So kindly get yourself tested, and do not stigmatize. Don't stigmatize anybody in your apartments or in your, you know, it can be you. The next person can be you. So kindly do not stigmatize. Do not attach anything horrible to the patient who's got a corona. They've gone through a lot and they've come back. please, you know, welcome them with a lot of claps, which, and we have seen a few videos where somebody has danced over their sister to come back home. It was a lovely video to watch. But still, social distancing is a must, mask is a must, and stay away. But, you know, there's no stigma attached to this. Please take care.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. We all the other queries and questions which have come, we will address them shortly. We're running short of time. I'd like to also add that in case if there is any doubts or in case if there is any questions that you have to, you know, ask, our doctors are available through the email IDs which I mentioned. So please get in touch with them and consult them on the video consultations. And also, we are a safe organization for you to visit the hospital, as we take care of all the precautions and safety measures as advised by the government. And we believe that whenever there is a need that has to be you know, addressed, and something that you are not aware in, which is also not possible through the virtual or the video consultations, please visit the hospital 24/7, Birthright by Rainbow Children's Hospital. We are available and we will be more than happy to attend to all of you and help you and support you during this pandemic, before the pandemic, after the pandemic. It's just going to be the same and we will be there all the time to help you. Moving on, we will have a very you know, interesting webinar that we are going to come up with again with another topic yet another time. And we will be signing off right now. Dr. Karamjeet Kaur and Dr. Kavita Kovi, I thank you both for being patiently you know, addressing all the queries, especially on a Saturday. And you know, this has brought in a lot of light for all our patients. And thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you once again. Thank you both of you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.